Chapter 5. There are a number of members of the plant world that are poisonous to man in one form or another. The chapter on wilderness survival delves a little into plants that are poisonous to eat. This chapter deals with plants that most commonly produce an adverse reaction when touched: poison ivy, poison sumac, and poison oak. At one time or another, most outdoorsmen come across one or all of these plants. However, some people react to them much more severely than others. Some people don't react at all. All of these plants produce toxic chemical agents that can cause anything from mild itching to severe blistering when they come in contact with skin. For sensitive people, only a small amount of toxic material is needed to produce a severe reaction. Most commonly, people come in contact with the toxins of these plants by walking through a patch or rubbing against poisonous climbing plants on trees and fences. However, there are other ways in which the toxin can be transferred. Often, dogs pick up the toxin on their coats and transfer it to persons who touch them. Insects pick up the poison on their feet and then land on exposed hands or arms. Hikers pick it up on their boots and pant legs and then touch it with bare hands when removing their clothing. The chemical that causes all the misery is a phenol found in the sap of the plant. This is why it is much more prevalent during the spring and early summer, the growing season, than during the fall or winter. The best method of dealing with poison ivy, poison sumac, and poison oak is to learn to recognize the plants and to avoid contact with them. Poison ivy. Poison ivy is by far the most common troublemaker. And commonly, it grows in thickets, open woods, sandy or rocky places, and on fence rows through most of the United States, except in some very arid regions. It is fairly abundant in southern Quebec, Ontario, the Great Lakes region, and Midwest. It is not known to grow above the tree line. And poison ivy is a twining, climbing vine that is almost shrub-like in appearance, but it can also support itself by aerial roots on the trunks of trees and on fences, or it can be found in partially shaded woodlots among low-growing plants such as ferns. Poison ivy has one easily recognizable characteristic: its compound leaf, consisting of three leaflets. These leaflets are a bright glossy green. They're oval shaped and smoothly textured. They are clustered together and have sharply tipped points and widely serrated edges. The flowers of poison ivy, present in the spring and early summer, are borne clusters and are small and inconspicuous. The flowers are dainty and vary in color from greenish-white to cream. Close-knit clusters of berries, also greenish-white or cream, develop from these flowers and become hard and waxy when mature. These berries persist through the winter and are a favorite harmless food for many species of birds. Not all poison ivy plants have berries. Such plants as poison ivy, poison oak, and poison sumac have toxic oils which can cause symptoms ranging from mild itching to severe skin blisters. Learn to recognize these plants. Poison sumac. Poison sumac is a coarse shrub or a small tree, generally ranging from 4 to 20 feet in height. It also has compound leaves, but the number of leaflets ranges from 7 to 13. These leaflets occur opposite each other on the branch and have one terminal leaflet at the end of the branch. Poison sumac prefers wet, boggy, acid soils and thus generally occurs in wooded swamps. Its range extends through most of the south and southeastern United States, along the east coast into New England, through New York, the Great Lakes, and the Midwestern states, and through southwestern Quebec and southern Ontario. Poison sumac flowers are similar to those of poison ivy, but they grow in hanging clusters and originate in the axils of the leaves. Poison sumac fruits are shiny, ivory-colored berries that hang in loose and droopy bunches, and these bunches may be as long as a foot. The berries persist throughout winter and provide food for many bird species. Poison oak. Poison oak is quite similar to poison ivy in appearance, but its leaves are thicker and smaller in size, and the ends of the leaves are rounded rather than pointed. Generally, poison oak has the same triple leaflet formation, but occasionally five leaflets are produced. The outline of the poison oak leaflet somewhat resembles the leaf of the white oak, hence its name. Poison oak. Poison oak prefers dry barrens, pinelands, and sands, and is most prevalent in the coastal regions. Along the Atlantic coast, it favors poor sandy soils and flourishes in the company of scrub oak and pine. Poison oak was one of the plants most feared by the Cherokee Indians. Poisoning from any of these plants may result any time after contact, from a few hours to a few days. The most common signs of contamination are itching and inflammation of the skin, followed by the emergence of watery blisters. However, the poison will not spread from a broken blister. The persistent development of new patches of itching and inflammation means that the toxin is being spread from contaminated clothing or from contact with more plants. The effects of these poisonous plants are very severe on some persons, sometimes requiring hospitalization. If you suspect that you have been in contact with any of these plants, the best procedure is to lather copiously with good strong yellow laundry soap, rinse thoroughly, and then repeat the procedure again. If after this, itching and inflammation still develop, the wisest procedure is to visit a family physician. A 1% solution of potassium permanganate swabbed over the infected area is known to give some relief from the itching. The brown stains produced from the material can be removed with lemon juice. Certain iron salts have also been used for the relief of itching, particularly ferric chloride. This material is mixed with a quarter glycerin, a quarter alcohol, and half water, and is swabbed on the affected spots, but it stains as well. Calamine lotion sometimes affords relief from minor itching. Stinging nettle. There are a few other plants besides the above that can be troublesome to the outdoorsman. Among them are the stinging or spurge nettles. The stinging nettle is the more common of the two. The stinging nettle is a bushy-looking plant with leaves that are very coarsely toothed and stiff bristles that sting on contact. The plants run from 6 to 30 inches in height and are found in waste places, sandhills, roadsides, and so on from Newfoundland west to Manitoba and through portions of the Midwestern United States east to northeastern Virginia. Again, the best way of dealing with stinging nettle is to learn to recognize and avoid it if you can. Chapter 6, Map and Compass. No one should venture into the wilderness without a compass, not even if his only intention is to go over the ridge to pick blueberries. Most outdoor recreationists today are urban dwellers. Often their knowledge about the country into which they are venturing is skimpy. Many campers and fishermen set off on trips into the wilderness or go for a walk from their camp without really knowing how to read landmarks. Many don't even carry a compass, and of those who do, many don't know how to use it. It is no surprise to me that newspapers and newscasts regularly carry reports of lost hikers, campers, and hunters. Knowing how to use a compass is a must for anyone who calls himself an outdoorsman. It is one of the primary outdoor skills. It's like using an axe. Experienced woodsmen, trappers, and such rarely rely on compass to find their way. But generally, they have an uncanny sense of direction. This sense is based on many things, including the lay of the land and the ability to see and absorb inconspicuous landmarks, and it comes as a result of many years in the bush. Most of us are not that fortunate. For example, it is difficult to completely lose a sense of direction on a sunny day, but an overcast day is something else. With no sun to guide us, we can get mixed up very easily. A compass will give the direction every time. A compass is a simple device. It is a steel needle, magnetized so that one end will always point to the Earth's magnetic pole, which lies 1,000 miles south of the true North Pole and a little west of the 100-degree meridian. Some compasses use a magnetic disc rather than a needle. Choosing a compass. Although compasses can be used for navigation and survey work, the outdoorsman's basic interest lies in keeping on a straight course to some distant point and then coming back again. For this, a small handheld compass with a swing needle or a disc is adequate. Such compasses come in many styles. The more sophisticated ones have needles that float in oil to dampen their swinging and have sights for taking headings. Others have levers which allow the needle to be taken off the pivot when the compass is not being used. I think that the very simple compasses are not wise choices for serious outdoorsmen. They are frequently chosen because they are small and inexpensive. A good compass, such as the Silva and others in its class, can be used for fairly sophisticated work. These are sturdy and dependable. For approximately $15 to $20, they are a good life insurance policy. All magnetic compasses react to iron and steel and other magnets, including other compasses. If you are carrying something made of iron, a rifle, a knife, or a belt buckle, it can throw off the needle. A simple test can be conducted to check for this. Simply place the compass on a low stump and walk away a few steps, keeping the needle where it is and giving it time to come to a full stop. And as you return, watch the needle to see if it swings towards you as you approach. If it does, you must find what is causing the needle to deviate and get rid of it. Using map and compass. Since the compass needle points to magnetic north, you must compensate for the difference between the positions of the true North Pole and the magnetic north. This difference is called declination, and it varies from nearly 0 degrees to 25 degrees east or west, depending on what part of the continent the reading is being taken from. The near 0 degrees applies if the reading is taken when the magnetic north and the true north are in line. However, the only time declination is of concern is when you are trying to follow a map that has both magnetic variance lines and the grid lines based on the true north.